Well, not so late this time.
Hey, poor! Hey, poor! Hey, poor! You don't have to be poor anymore! Jesus is here!
The loudspeaker spoke up and said, Christianity is stupid.
Greetings, fellow worker slaves, podcasting at 128 kilobits from the Fortress of Squalitude, located not far from the Redneck Mecca. This is the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. I'm your host, Tucker. Professor Fuzznuts is off being a dick because he's mad at me since I gave him his medication. Ash, Buddha, and Lord Squeakington are in my room. Yes, it's a podcast hosted by a guy and his cats. Get over it. This is a news show episode where Hertzy Hertz and I read stories from the news related to things like secularism, atheism, or we find just plain interesting. Next episode will be more of the Gnostic text nonsense. And it's still the Acts of Thomas. This bit's a little bit better. I mean, that's not saying much, but it's a little bit better. So, let's give a quick rundown on all the fun stuff before we get to the news. First and foremost, it being the first of the month, I want to thank every Patreon supporter for their continued support of the podcast, because I really need it right now. I took Fuzznuts to the vet this past weekend. They checked him out. He seems to be okay. I'm waiting on some blood work to come back to see if he really is okay. I mean, this is sophisticated blood work stuff that they're doing, so. The only problem he had was some ear funk that they gave me some medicine to hopefully clear it up. He's still an asshole to Buddha, and I can't let them be alone with one another, which is disappointing. I was hoping he had something wrong with him, and then, you know, they'd shoot him full of antibiotics, and he'd clear up, and he'd be fine, but that doesn't seem to be the case. So unless something from the blood work comes back and says, hey, there's this problem, you need to deal with it, then it looks like he's just an asshole. Well, I should say a bigger asshole than he has been. And that whole experience was pretty pricey. It was $350 for everything. So, was not terribly thrilled about that, but, you know, obviously you got to take care of your babies, so, you know. And I'm glad that so far nothing's turned up. Like I said, they haven't got the results back yet for the blood work they sent out, so who knows. But in other news, work last week was fun. Not for anything that I did, thankfully. But we have this machine at work that's called an injection machine. And we inject saline and rice flour into certain products. We do this because that enables us. The saline is a bit of a preservative. It also replaces some of the blood that leaks out of the meat while it's sitting waiting to be processed. And the rice flour helps block the blood vessels to keep the saline solution in there. Now, I hate the injection machine. I'm the only one who is fully trained to operate the thing, and I'm the only one who actually operates it the way you're supposed to, and it's a piece of shit. It's got some problems. The biggest problem is that it is top-heavy. So, this thing is about a foot and a half wide. The bulk of it is about 4 feet long. It's got overhanging sections and part of it that are about a foot and a half long. And it is about 9 feet high. And the center of gravity of the thing is up top. It's on wheels, and we have to move it around in the facility. Well, not in the facility, in the room where we use it. And it's top-heavy, and you combine that with the fact that the floors are all sloped to go to the drain, so it likes to wobble. Well, one day last week, let me add this. It's very, very heavy. I don't know what the weight on that thing is, but one person cannot push it around easily. You can kind of get it to move, a few inches or so. But if you really want to move it around, you have to have more people, or you do what a lot of folks do, and you get the tow motor and pick it up with that. Well, the problem with that is the machine is unbalanced, so if you're not real careful when you pick it up with the tow motor, it wobbles greatly. And I do everything I can to avoid moving it with the tow motor, because I don't want to be the asshole on the tow motor when that thing falls over. Which is what happened to the second shift lead last week. He picked it up, and it toppled over. Didn't slam into the floor, but it smacked into the sinks we have mounted on the wall, nearly ripped one of them off, and bent the pegs that the wheels are mounted on. And it took them 3 tow motors to be able to get the thing back up and then moved over so they could lean it up against the wall for the morning maintenance crew to come and work on it. And I was so very glad that I was not the one who had been driving the tow motor, because my ass would have been in trouble. So that was the big excitement. I mean, it took them 2 days to fix the machine. And they're not done with it yet. They're going to... They finally realized, well, gosh, this thing is top-heavy. Maybe we need to put it on a wider base so it's less... it'll be more stable. I tried to explain to them how they could do that and have it sit lower to the ground, but they didn't like my idea. Yeah, don't listen to the guy who was a machinist for a decade and who made aerospace components for a good portion of that. He doesn't know what the fuck he's talking about, so. All right. There's just a couple other little bits and pieces I want to go over before we get to Hertzie and I reading the news. First and foremost, this is probably going to be one of the only episodes where Marjorie, whatever her name is, Green, Marjorie Taylor Green, that's her name. And the reason I'm doing this is because she is a potential heir apparent to Trump. She's clearly aiming for at least the VP slot in the 2024 election, if not actually thinking about running for president herself. And as you will recall, Donald Trump got more coverage in the 2016 campaign than any of the other candidates, both the Republicans or the Democrats. He got more coverage by the media than Bernie and Hillary combined. So if sunlight's the best disinfectant, he shouldn't have been president. And he was. So I am not going to put anything out about her, if at all possible. There's going to, I realize I don't have a giant audience, so it's not like I can mute her. But I'm not going to contribute to people boosting her up and getting her attention and popularity out there. I am going to simply hype and focus on the first Democrat who has announced that he's going to be challenging her in the 2022 election. And that is a gentleman by the name of Marcus Flowers. I will have a link to his Twitter account in the show notes. And I would ask all of you who are on Twitter to follow him and to share everything you can that he posts. We have to get the volume of his stuff up above anything that Marjorie Taylor Greene does. That is going to be the best shot we have at beating her. We've got to nip Trumpism in the bud as best we can, and the only way we're going to be able to do that is if we hype and promote the people opposed to her without boosting her whenever possible. Coincidentally, it turns out I have an interweb friend who actually knows Marcus Flowers. And I've known this guy for about a decade now, actually almost a decade and a half. And he and I have been on opposite sides of a lot of issues until fairly recently. He did not vote for Trump in 2016. But he calls himself a conservative, yet he supports things like universal health care, easy access to birth control, things like that. He knows Marcus. He really likes Marcus, says Marcus is a genuine human being. This guy is someone I know well enough, even though I've never met him in the flesh and we've only interacted on the internet, that if he trusts somebody, I'm going to give that person a little bit of a benefit of the doubt. Obviously, this guy is religious and he is a Calvinist. So there are going to be things that he and I disagree about. But if he likes Marcus, then Marcus is probably a really decent human being. And he's certainly vastly superior to Marjorie Taylor Greene. So if you've got any spare cash, you may want to look at donating to Marcus via Act Blue so that he can compete against her because she's got lots and lots of money. And, just sharing his stuff on Facebook, on Twitter, any form of social media where you can find him will be a big help. Because the goal is to swamp the signal. Swamp her signal. If we can do that, then there's a good chance that she'll lose the election if she's not tossed out of office before then, which we can hope. And there are some questions about her that indicate that she may not be able to serve her full term. She certainly seems to have some ties to the shitheads who did the whole insurrection thing on January 6th. And there's actually questions as to whether or not she really lives in the district she's representing. So we'll see. But that is one of my primary focuses right now is getting him boosted up, getting attention to him, because, even if he loses, if she is wiped out of the national media, that is a huge benefit for all of us. All right, what other thing I will say before I get out of here and get to Hertzie and I reading the news is that part of the reason this episode is late is because they changed my work schedule at the last minute, more or less. I got a text message from my boss on Sunday, says, oh, hey, instead of coming in at noon on Monday, come in at 8 a.m. Well, I had arranged things for what I expected my schedule. And then when they changed it, that threw everything out of whack. So, that was fun, but that's not really surprising. They're really good about that. They're trying to follow the Walmart model, I suspect, and are doing shit like this to kill the union. it will not work. As far as I'm concerned, I will stay a union man for the rest of my life if I can. Because after the way my last job treated me, I want a union where I work. So, you know, I'm lucky. I live 6 minutes away on foot from work, and they pay better than just about any other job in town. So, you know, they're really going to have to work hard to get me to quit. And I don't think they're going to want to do all that, because then they start crossing lines where, you know, things get illegal, or they conflict with, you know, they butt up against the union. And the union's not great, but I have seen more than one person who's lost their job get their job back thanks to the union. So, yeah, it's not something I'm ready to give up on. Okay. Let's get Hertzy and I doing the news.
Everybody needs something to believe in, don't they, Reverend?
Bow down thine ear, O Lord, and hear me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my soul, for I am holy. O thou my God, save thy servant that trusteth in thee. Save him from this big mouth coos with a motor-driven ass who... Forgive me, Lord. I speak not in vain, but this little bitch provokes me so.
Oh, Jesus. At least I can stay in character.
In religionnews.com, Southern Baptist leaders decry stone-cold racist letter to Dwight Kisick.
Sounds good to me.
All right. The Southern Baptist Convention officials have strongly condemned a letter sent by a critic of the Southern Baptist Church to the Reverend Dwight McKissick, a black pastor in Texas who recently announced he was pulling his church out of the Southern Baptists of Texas Convention. Right now, I'm not really seeing a problem with Reverend Dwight. Sounds like this is a very good idea.
Yeah, sort of the least you could do.
Yeah. The January 25th letter came from John V. Rutledge of Colorado Springs, Colorado. Oh, well, there's his first problem. I was going to say, I think we talked about a little bit about Colorado before. I had coworkers in Colorado, and it was like, oh, yes, there are spots of Colorado, and then there are spots of Colorado.
Yeah, the Air Force Academy is located in Colorado and is unfortunately overran with evangelical types.
I'm shocked, I tell you, in Colorado. Yeah. Which is basically the second place Mormons go. Maybe third. Idaho's another big one.
Yeah. And there's a weird pocket in Arizona that's on the border with Utah.
Oddly enough, they don't seem to come to Minnesota.
Hmm. Too cold for them.
Actually, yeah, people have run into Mormon missionaries, and none of them are ever prepared for Minnesota winters. So, honestly, it's one of those, like, if I see two Mormon missionaries here in winter and they don't have mittens, it's going to be like, okay, seriously, nobody warned you? Let's go get you some freaking mittens, because this is not... No, you're going to freeze your little fingers off.
Oh, God, yeah. And, I mean, you know, you live in a state where they're going, well, the high today will be a blistering minus 20 degrees.
Oh, yeah. I woke up this morning where the wind chill was negative 10. We have had an entire very mild winter this year.
Yeah. If the wind chill is negative 10, it's mild. If the actual temperature is negative 10, then it's probably a little above average.
Well, it does kind of depend on where you are in the state. In the cities, typically we'll get a few cold spots where it gets to like negative, negative, negative. But oftentimes you'll have a lot of teens, zero to teens for a bit. And then occasionally it will get really warm and we'll get up to like 30. yeah. when I was going into the office and taking the bus, it was like checking the weather every night, being like, okay, tomorrow is going to be this, so I need to wear this many layers.
Yeah.
But John B. Rutledge from Colorado Springs, who published two books that find fault with the Southern Baptist Church. Okay. In recent years, the Southern Baptist Convention has been repenting foolishly. That's his foolishly, not my foolishly. Mm-hmm. The quote-unquote sin of whiteness, and has rebaptized itself as an exemplar of diversity. Okay, I'm thinking Mr. Rutledge, and I'm using the term Mr. very, very loosely. I have a feeling that this person hasn't been around the Baptist church for a while.
I mean, the whole reason the Southern Baptists exist to begin with is because they didn't like them colored folks. And that's being mildly offensive. Because I'm sure they would have used another term back then.
Well, Rutledge does get very close to that term, and I am not going to touch that with a 10-foot pole.
Because the whole reason SBC was created was because various religious schools were butthurt over the fact that they might have to let brown people in. So they rejiggered a few things, and that kind of worked for a while, and then they got all anti-abortion and suddenly got a lot more members. But the core of their movement or organization is indubitably racism.
Cool.
Yeah.
And I mean that loosely.
Yeah. Because that's what we need more in America.
Yeah. Well, Rutledge definitely seems to be doing their part for that.
Yeah.
And I totally think that the Reverend Dwight has every reason to pull his church out and wave a couple middle fingers while he's going.
And one hopes that others will do the same.
Yes.
All right. From hiphopdx.com, Kanye West reportedly facing a $30 million lawsuit from nearly 1,000 Sunday service members.
What?
Only 1,000. It should be higher. Kanye West's Sunday service choir is going from working with Yee in the pews to challenging the multi-time Grammy Award winner in a court of law. According to Page Six, nearly 1,000 Sunday service members, and I gotta say, kind of surprising that it's that high if you're talking about a general total, but at the same time, it's also kind of surprising that the number is so low if there are more than 1,000 members, because I really would think they would all sue his ass over this shit.
I'm still trying to figure out what they're suing him for.
Well, unpaid wages.
Oh, that'll do. That'll do.
Yeah, because basically, you know, they got a flat rate for being at events, which you can kind of justify. But at the same time, the things they were having to do at those events, it's like, no, flat rate doesn't cut it. And also a lot of them haven't been paid. I mean,
yeah,
you know, it's one thing to say, okay, look, you know, we're going to need you for certain stuff, so we're going to pay you this flat rate per month. And then you find out that, oh, well, the stuff you're needing us for involves us standing for 8 to 12 hours a day, multiple days, and we are not allowed to have any kind of break. You know, like, say, we need to go pee, or we want to eat lunch, or something like that.
No breaks.
Yeah. I mean, you know, Kanye has done some good music over the years, but I got nothing when it comes to supporting him for a long time now.
Yeah, I was going to say, he kind of lost me after the, not that he really had me before, but when he did that thing to Taylor Swift, because my favorite, he's like, Beyonce had the best music video. And I'm like, and if you had waited 5 minutes, everybody else freaking agreed with you, dude.
Oh, you've brought the Beyonce thing up.
Crap.
We got to talk about this.
Okay.
Right, because there's some issues with that, right? Give Beyonce all the credit that she deserves because she's hugely talented.
Yeah.
There were rebuttal memes about that which were unintentionally racist.
I'm shocked, I tell you, shocked.
Because, you know, Beyonce did, you know, the stuff that he was talking about, Beyonce had a lot of help on.
Which, I was going to say, every singer has help on music videos and stuff like that. None of that shit's done in a vacuum.
Well, yes and no, because as people were eager to point out, Bohemian Rhapsody was really just Freddie Mercury for the bulk of it. I mean, obviously the other band members did vocals and things like that, but, you know, they have a list of the stuff that for Beyonce, you know, it's a whole bunch of producers and things like that. And then they have the list for Freddie Mercury, and it's far shorter. Okay.
So?
Well,
I mean, different people are going to do things different ways.
Right. But their argument was, well, Freddie Mercury is better than Beyonce for this reason. But they all ignore the fact that Prince did literally everything on his albums.
Okay, going back to Beyonce for just a moment, and actually this does do with Prince as well, Beyonce just knows how to delegate.
Well, yeah. I there's
damn thing.
Well, I
was going to say, right now, I'm giving her a heck of a lot more props than the other two, because it's like, great, you actually didn't force yourself, or didn't do everything. You don't have to.
You're not wrong. But Prince, and I don't know about Freddie Mercury, but Prince ran into the issue that, you know, he couldn't get his record labels to promote his stuff the way he wanted to, so he started teaching himself how to do that shit.
Well, yeah, and that makes sense.
Yeah, and you know, full credit to Prince. I don't know as much about Freddie Mercury as I do Prince, but Prince taught himself everything for the most part when it came to doing an album. His first album, he did it the way you would traditionally do it. You know, you've got a backing band, you've got engineers in the mixing the stuff and things like that, and he wasn't happy about it. So he sat down and talked to the engineers and learned how they did the things that they did. He also self-taught himself instruments and things like that. And then that's how he did his albums. There are a lot of benefits to having somebody, you know, if you're working on a project, there are a lot of benefits that come from having outside input. But at the same time, if you're somebody who's able to self-teach yourself hugely complicated things involved with doing music, you ain't no fucking dummy.
I'll agree with that. We also just, I was going to say, taking a step back with that, we don't know how much Beyonce knows.
No, that's true.
Just because she had somebody do it doesn't mean she doesn't know how.
Yeah, that's true. And I mean,
it's great that, and it is awesome that Prince was able to do that. That's fucking awesome.
Right, right. And there are things that hugely talented people do that are just throwaway stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, they're not concerned about every single detail because they're more interested in the broad picture than, you know, every aspect of it. And, you know, I have to say this. I'm not a fan of Prince. I like some of his music, but I'm, you know, a lot of it I'm just like, it's not my bag. But I hugely respect him for the kinds of things that he could do.
I live in Prince country, and I honestly am not the biggest fan either. Like, I think there's been something about a Prince museum, and there's so many people like, oh my gosh, this is so awesome. I'm just like, yep.
I live in the home of country music, and I cannot stand 99% of it, so I feel your pain.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and like the few songs that I heard on the radio growing up, I was like, oh yeah, that's good. But it's like, it never... I also didn't grow up in the age where, like, Prince was, like, the thing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I did.
Just after.
I did. I mean, you know, everybody's, oh, well, this and that. And it's like, you know, a lot of the stuff he did is, you know, it's really good for what it is, but it's not, you know, if you're going to, you know, talk about epitomes of various musical genres, it's not, you know, the stuff he did is not necessarily going to be on par with things other people in different genres did, even though he is ahead of a lot of people in various genres.
Yeah. I will say, Pete did those good. Oh crap, now I forgot what I was gonna say. Never mind.
Oh.
Well, Kanye West is getting sued, and oh yeah, he was a Jehovah's Witness, so that also kind of had like a, well, okay.
Yeah, for me. Yeah, he was, that was, and that didn't happen until later in Prince's career.
Which is funny, because he's like, oh no, all these songs are totally that, and I was looking going, really? Yeah. Really, that has nothing to do with sex? I'm a young teenager and I can see that.
Well, you might remember the song Sugar Walls.
Nope.
Okay. He wrote it. Gosh, I need to look this up because I don't want to deprive a woman of credit.
We'll just put, like, you know, music, the that, what is it called? Music that goes in between movies.
Jeopardy theme.
Oh.
Sheena Easton. He wrote a song for Sheena Easton called Sugar Walls. And it came out in 1984. It was hugely controversial because it had, amongst many other things, the phrase, come inside my sugar walls.
Oh my.
Yeah, I mean, that's like, okay, we know what she's talking about. And people are hugely butthurt over that when it was released. And I had never heard that song when it was current. And then, like, 10 years later, I heard it. I'm just going, well, okay, I can understand why the religious nutters would be butthurt over this, but it ain't nothing, really. And this is a thing I've noticed that nobody seems to be talking about. When it comes to music, women of color are more heavily censored than anyone else.
I'm shocked, I tell you, shocked. This is a shocking episode.
But nobody talks about this.
That's true.
That's what gets me is, I mean, you have all these quote unquote woke people talking about how important female artists are, especially ones of color, and they don't mention the censorship. Lizzo's Truth Hurts.
I've been meaning to get into Lizzo.
You know, one of the lines in it is, I took a DNA test and I am 100% that bitch.
See, that's the reason I want to listen to I want to get into Lizzo.
Okay. But when they play it on the radio, they delete bitch.
See, at least in St. Paul, Minnesota, that's across the board. Like, we can't have any swearing on the radio. Which, I mean, on one hand...
Oh, yes, you can. I guarantee you that they play the uncensored version of the Who song, Who Are You?
And okay, so I get to listen to the rock station. It was like 93X, and they censored everything.
Trust
Kid
me.
Rock, Metallica. I don't think they let any of those. They always got the censored version of the song.
Trust me. Every single time. Trust me. Radio stations are more than happy to play Who Are You by The Who, uncensored, even though it includes the line, Who the fuck are you?
Okay, so I listened to this radio station for years. They never played a goddamn swear word. In fact, I had a friend from from Iowa, like, oh my gosh, everything is censored. How do you stand it? I'm not saying that women of color aren't more censored. I'm guessing in places where they have looser censorship rules that it definitely is a thing. But at least as far as I know here, everything is censored. I'm not allowed to swear when I was doing the radio show.
Well, yeah, but I live in the buckle of the Bible Belt.
Yes.
And they don't... Trust me, they do not censor a lot of shit.
They may not censor a lot of shit where you are, but don't tell me what Minnesota fucking does.
but it's one of those things. It really depends on the radio station you're listening to. At least here.
They all did it. Okay, there. In Minnesota, everybody played censored. There is no swear, at least at that time. I have not admittedly listened to radio recently. Because I'm listening to podcasts all the time and nobody's going to fucking censor that shit.
Yeah. Hang on a second. Let me listen to something here. Nope. Okay. There is a song. And this is played on the same radio station that censors Lizzo's Truth Hurts.
Mm-hmm.
And they play that. Gosh. I will look it up.
They
now
play a thing with a swear word.
Worse than that. Okay. Because Lizzo's is, I am 100% that bitch. Bitch, mm-hmm. Not that bad of a word.
No.
Okay. There is a radio station here that plays a song that has a line that is totally not censored. We're going to get higher than a motherfucker.
I was going to say, I mean, I guess that's worse than bitch. I don't take swearing very seriously, so well, that's a little harder.
Yeah, I know. But there are... I can't find the playlist on the station's website, and I'm not going to dig around it. But, no, they censor that, and you know, we have a radio at work. We can put it on whatever station we want. In my department, on my shift, there's me and one other guy. He likes to listen to the really shitty herb. When I call it really shitty, I say that because they have, like, I've seen their playlist. They have like 10 songs a day they play, and it's just on repeat the whole day.
Oof.
Yeah, okay. They censor, and it's an iHeart radio station, okay? Mm-hmm. So, you know, big corporate monopoly. The station I put on when I have control of the radio is the top 40 iHeart radio station in this area. So, you know, I mean, we're not talking like one of us is listening to the Megacorp station and the other one of us is listening to the indie station in town. We're both listening to the Megacorp station. And the censorship on the urban, because, you know, only black people listen to rap, is far higher than on the top 40 station, despite the overlap and stuff. You know, wet ass pussy.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, nobody's going to play wet ass pussy on the air. They're going to censor it, and it's going to be wet and gushy. Everybody censors when they say, hit me in the back of my throat. They cut out the throat. But nobody censors a song about a black guy or a white guy with a big dick doing something like that.
Nope.
Yeah. And after George Floyd got killed, the urban station started censoring all the rap songs that talked about violence. I mean, you know, if I owned a station that played rap music after George Floyd got killed, every fucking song I could possibly think of that was fuck the police or in that vein would be on constant rotation.
Can't blame you there.
Yeah, because, I mean, let's face it, George Floyd was murdered in cold blood. And
yep.
Everybody, regardless of ethnic origin, should be pissed as fuck about that.
Yep.
And the, you know, like I said, they quit playing it on the urban station. They would usually play the pop-up, which I don't know if you've heard or not.
Nope.
It's a song by a rapper who basically talks about showing up at a party and, you know, that's being held by rich people and robbing them. Well, they quit playing that. And it's like, why would you quit playing that after somebody of color got murdered? Are you trying to not inspire people of color to rise up against their oppressors?
I'd like to say something like the world may never know, but I'm pretty sure we all know.
Yeah. Well, it's like, and you're too young to remember this. Gavitt Morris was on Saturday Night Live. You may or may not know who he is.
Nope.
He's a black actor. He was on Martin's TV show. You know, Martin Lawrence's TV show on Fox sometimes. And one of the things that he was famous for on Saturday Night Live was they had this sketch called Death Row Follies.
That... Okay.
Right. So, you know, they're going... The premise is that, you know, they're going to have folks in prison who are on death row do vaudeville acts for entertainment.
And nobody thought that this was a bad idea.
Oh, you don't know. You don't know. Gavitt Morris wrote the script. I mean, it was suggested, you know, Lorne Michaels, who's the producer of Saturday Night Live, said, okay, folks, let's do a sketch about Death Row Follies. You all go into your rooms and figure it out. Gavitt Morris wrote the script that finally hit the air. And he comes out in the sketch and sings a song called, which goes, I'm gonna get me a shotgun and shoot all the whiteys I see.
Okay, that's good.
Right. It is funny as fuck. You can no longer find that sketch on YouTube.
Oh.
You could find it before George Floyd was murdered. Now you can't. Methinks NBC's lawyers said, no, we're going to pull this shit down. You can't even find it on the official page for SNL that they have on YouTube.
That sucks.
Yeah. And Gavitt Morris, you can find, however, where Gavitt Morris got the inspiration for that. He was involved in some project that had one of the really early black celebrities. Oh, God, I cannot think of his name now. Let me look it up. I think it was Harry Belafonte. It could have been somebody else. But anyways, they were involved in a TV show. I forget the name of it. But anyways, it was a forerunner for reality shows. They would go around the country and talk to ordinary people.
Mm-hmm.
And so they were there in some place in the Deep South. And this woman says, oh... You know, talking to this woman in the audience, and she says, I've written over 300 songs. And they're like, oh, we've got to, you know, hear this. We've got, you know, do something with, you know, here's the piano, go play on it. And so she starts playing the song, which the host of the show, and I don't remember his name, I'm not good, Art Linkletter, and you know, she starts playing the song, and Art Linkletter and all the others realize, oh no, we've made a horrible mistake, because she starts singing, I'm gonna get me a shotgun and kill all the N-words I see. Yeah, so when Gavitt Morris was told, hey, Death Row Follies, come up with something, he's like, what the hell can I do about it? And he remembered what Harry Belafonte told him. And he says, oh, that's perfect. Let me just change a couple of words and we're golden.
Yeah, I was going to say that is quite possibly the only way that could. Because that is just so laden with issues.
Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, you know, there are stuff. Everybody says the original cast of Saturday Night Live is the best. and they had some insanely brilliant sketches, but there's a number of them today you're like, oh no, you should never have done that.
Oh yeah, like we were like Groundhog Day was not that long ago. It was earlier this week, and I put some GIFs of Bill Murray's Groundhog Day, and like one of my coworkers and I were talking, and I'm like, I don't recall, like I'm thinking back on it, and I'm like, I don't think there was that much cringe, which that's saying something. Because a lot of movies I watch and I'm just like, now and I'm just like, oh, this is not gonna go. Yeah. Like, I'm curious about getting Start the Revolution Without Me and just being like, and how much cringe is there? Because that was made in 1970.
Yeah. Well, you remember me talking about that TV show Barney Miller,
mm-hmm.
which was hugely progressive for its era, but you watch it now and you're like, oh my God, no, you did not do this. You could not do this. Because they had, they would make ethnic jokes about the Asian characters on the show. And you're like, oh, that's terrible. But, at the same time, you realize, no, this is one of the first times that an Asian has been portrayed positively or even actually on a primetime show, and he was a regular character rather than somebody who was in a guest spot.
Yeah, I was going to say positively sounds like it might be a wee bit of a stretch.
Yeah, it's, and there's a lot of stuff like that. It's like, oh, gosh, it's terrible. It's absolutely terrible. But if you were around then, you realize it was groundbreaking because it was the first time you ever saw any of these people.
That really is a nice collection. Must have taken you a long time to hunt down all that history.
Yeah. Well, let us move on to the next story.
What is the next story?
It's archaeology news. Why do I keep getting stuck with archaeology news?
But this is pretty cool.
See, this is why I should have gone second. Could have talked about Kanye West.
No,
all right.
No, the second, this is not, the archaeology story does not talk about Kanye.
Yeah, exactly. If you had gone first, I get to talk about Kanye. All right. I don't know.
.com. Check the show notes for that URL, because it's
horrible. Yes. Reconstruction of the face of a 5,000-year-old woman in Iran. The face of a 5,000-year-old Iranian woman has been recently reconstructed with the latest scientific archaeology methods by Iranian researchers.
Skip the parentheses.
Yeah. Moving forward. Maryam Tabshibin of the Cultural Heritage News Agencies of Iran had previously noted of researchers having excavated a 4,800-year-old artificial eye along with a skeleton and other findings from the burnt city. The site of the burnt city has also yielded numerous interesting finds, including an ancient measuring ruler, a backgammon game, or game pieces, an animation device. That is so cool! Researchers have ascertained that the artificial eye belonged to a woman aged 25 to 30 who hailed from a higher echelon of the local society of the burnt city. Interestingly, the woman's gravesite also yielded vessels of clay, a leather bag, a mirror of bronze, and various other ornaments. Professor Michael Harris, a specialist in the field of optometry at the University of California in Berkeley, has stated that, quote, it is unlikely such attention and effort would have been paid to a commoner. She may have been a member of a royal family or otherwise wealthy individual, end quote. Prosthetics were, of course, known in the ancient era, with references made to an artificial eye of gold in the Hebrew texts. The prosthetic found in Iran, however, is different in that it is evidence of the oldest attempt at making this as quote-unquote realistic as possible. Professor Mansur Sayyid Sajid, who supervised the excavation, has stated, quote, "At first glance, it seemed natural tar mixed with animal fat had been used in the making. Whoever made the eye likely used a fine gold wire thinner than half a millimeter to draw the most delicate eye capillaries," end quote. Tar with animal fat. I mean, I definitely give them props for using what they had around, but that's definitely ingredients for an eye. All right, I got to see what this... Oh, she's gorgeous.
Yeah, yeah. And she was tall. She was over 6 feet. Which,
dang.
Back then, you know, the average height for a male would have been like 5'4". A tall woman would have been probably around 5 foot. She was a giant.
Well, I can finally tell my sister at least at one time she would have been tall.
How tall is your sister?
5'1". I am 5'7".
Ages ago, I was dating a Vietnamese gal.
Mm-hmm.
She was 5'2", roughly. She came up to the top of my chin. I'm only 5'11", so I'm above average height for a male, but I'm not stupidly tall.
Mm-hmm.
And I worked with this gal who was a little shorter than her, and I says, "So, let me guess, you're about 5 foot." And she's like, "I am 5'5". But man,
well, when we were growing up, that 1 inch meant a lot because my mother is 5 foot.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's. I've known people who are like terribly concerned because their daughter was a big baby, and they're like, "Well, I'm worried she'll grow up to be tall, and this could be cause problems." And I'm like, speaking as someone who's nearly 6 foot tall, having somebody you're dating who is the same height of you opens up a lot of possibilities.
Moving on.
Well, you know, I mean, there's, you know.
Moving on.
Nobody can control how tall they are, really.
No.
So, but, you know, it's like, one should not discriminate upon potential folks in a relationship based on if they're tall or short.
Yeah, that I can agree with.
I mean, you know, it's nice when you've got somebody who's kind of close to your height, but that doesn't mean anything, you know. You should not seek out some people who are your equal in height or close. I knew a couple where the dude was like 5 foot and his girlfriend was 5'10". And how he managed to hook up with her was he just looked at her and said, "So do you think it would actually physically be possible for us to do it?"
Mm.
I mean, hey, it worked, so. Good line.
Maybe then. Don't know if it would go so well now.
Ow. Okay. So from news.uaf.edu, blue beads in the tundra. Glass beads the size of blueberries found by archaeologists in a Brook Range house pit might be the first European item ever to arrive in North America. Well, that's a bit of a stretch because, after all, Leif Erikson was in the Americas well before Columbus.
Fact.
But he was on the eastern side, and this was found on the western side. Predating the arrival of Columbus by a few decades. Go ahead.
I was thinking, wasn't there, like, Magellan? Didn't he, like, traverse the whole thing before Columbus?
No, he was after Columbus. Not long after him.
I was going to say, I still give the survivors of Magellan's crew a heck of a lot more whatever than Columbus.
Yeah, well,
I would say Magellan himself, but he didn't quite make it that far. Spoilers!
I'm not going to look up when Leif Erikson lived, but there were there were tales from like the 10th or 11th century, maybe the 12th century, of people who had gone from Europe to South America and come back. But there's no real hard evidence. This, however, really seems to indicate something was going on, because you've got, and all the, you know, you've got Erikson and whomever that guy was who came after him, they all landed on the eastern part of the U.S. This shit was found in Alaska, which is the western part of the U.S. So that's kind of a huge deal. I'm going to skip some of this. I'm sorry. Let me throw him down. Get him to get off of me. Come on, buddy. Ow, 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 ow. This is a huge... Go ahead.
I was going to say, I'm just glad I don't have to edit this.
But this is a huge deal because it shows that there was some trade between the western part of Asia and the eastern part of Asia and the western part of the U.S. And these beads would have been brought into the Americas before Columbus showed up. That's a huge deal. I mean, that is really a huge deal.
Quite. Sorry, I am also looking at Leif Erikson because I may or may not have a little bit of pride in that one, being Norwegian Danish. and German.
Like a whole bunch of people from that part of the world ever settled in places like Minnesota.
Yeah. Granted, there's one thing I do love is that the story is that the Vikings came and it was Minnesota because the idea is that they went through the Great Lakes and found their way, to Lake Superior. And the fact that they survived Lake Superior is freaking enough. But because anybody has not heard about it, Lake Superior is huge. And pissy.
That you're talking to a guy who has...
I am talking to a guy.
...had experience on the Great Lakes in bad weather.
I would like to... Yeah, I was going to say, I have not had my own experiences, but I have seen enough to know to stay the frack away from Duluth in November.
Okay, when I was in eighth grade, I grew up in Ohio, of course, okay? So...
You have mentioned that.
Yeah. Or maybe it was seventh grade. I don't remember. Anyways, we would take a class trip to an island in Lake Erie called Put in Bay Island. And we would do this in May.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you kind of have an idea what the weather would be like. It could be nice and comfy, and then it could be really shitty.
Yep.
So we went, when we went, we had, because there is Put in Bay Island, there is South Bass Island, and then there's, you know, the homeland of, or the mainland of the United States, that part of Ohio. And when we, you know, we were planning the trip, they said, okay, here's what's going to happen. And it was seventh grade now that I remember it. We're going to go to this, you know, this part of northern Ohio. If the weather's good, we will fly on planes across the Great Lakes to South Bass Island. These planes were not, commercial airliners. They were small planes that held maybe six people at a time. And if the weather's good, we'll fly back. Well, the weather was good when we went over to South Bass Island, and then we took boats from South Bass Island to Put in Bay Island. Put in Bay Island is not huge. We couldn't play kickball on the island because the largest space where you could do it was still so small that if you kicked the ball wrong, it would fall off into the water. So when we were coming home, the weather was bad. And they're like, we're going to have to take the ferry boats from South Bass to the main. The ferry, well, you've seen a ferry boat, you know, big enough you can load cars into it. And this had a nice passenger cabin on it. The waves were so bad, I could look out the back window of the passenger cabin of the ferry, and all I could see would be a wall of water. There were people who were just curled up around the toilet bowls. I mean, it was vicious and nasty.
Yeah, when they say the Great Lakes don't give up the dead, they're not messing around.
No. I can't think of the guy. I'm not going to look him up. He did a song called The Wreck of the Edmund Fitzgerald. Which is about a cargo ship that was lost in the Great Lakes in the 70s.
Yep.
And basically what happened is the wave action was so bad that the water parted and the bow of the ship struck the bottom of the lakes without there being any water.
I was going to say, I mean, admittedly, to a point, there's a lot of it's guessing, because it's like nobody survived the Edmund Fitzgerald. Everybody died.
Yeah, well, they found the wreck of the ship some years ago, and they've been able to figure out a lot of shit about it.
They're still, and as much as they're able to figure out, I'm just saying that it's like, again, nobody was there.
Yeah, there's a whole lot that's been lost, but it's... You know, I mean, when you're talking about having a wave that's tall enough to reveal the bottom of the body of water it's in, that's a pretty fucking big wave.
Yeah. Lake Superior does not mess around.
Yeah. No, none of the lakes do.
However, Lake Superior is the biggest.
Yeah. Well, that's probably why they call it Superior.
Ew. Yes. But yes, though the whole thing, back to Leif Erikson, mm-hmm. The whole thing that at least my friends and I used to laugh at was the idea that, you know, the big strong Vikings came over to the middle of Minnesota. You know, just were like, okay, great, we're going to start up a settlement. And then, of course, you know, the Indians people were like, no. Beat the ever-living crap out of them and sent them crying home to mommy. Or at least that's what we're pretty sure happened.
It's not unreasonable.
Oh, no. No.
Lewis Black's The White Album, he did when he was in Minnesota. And he talks about not the Viking settlements, but the, you know, the stuff in the 18th and 19th century when, you know, there's that big wave of immigrants from Northern Europe coming over saying, we're tired of the fucking cold. We're going to go to America. It's a great place. And they go along and get to Minnesota and they're like, oh, fuck, we're home. This is where we were.
Actually, oh, where is it? Is it? Oh, it's not within reaching distance. There's a book called Scandinavian Humor and Other Myths that actually talks about how Norway and such oftentimes can be warmer than Minnesota. So not only did they go to some place that also, I mean, there's more sun in Minnesota because we don't have like the midnight sun in summer.
Right.
But it's not necessarily warmer.
Well, there's been a few times when I've been chatting with people in Canada, and because of the weird way things work due to global warming, they've actually had higher temperatures there than I've had here at the same time.
That's not good.
It's like, wow, okay. And of course, they're used to it, so, you know, it could be 20 below here and 15 below there, and they're like, ah, God, it's so hot. You know,
yeah.
And we're all like, oh no, we're gonna die.
Sorry.
No, don't. I'm a Yankee. Don't apologize. I mean, the people here panic about snow that I guarantee you wouldn't even notice that there was snow falling from the sky. It's so thin.
Fair.
So.
All right. But yeah.
4, 3, 2, 1. Let me know.
You want to hit the next one?
Space news. See, I'm noting, like, I'm seeing patterns now that I've done this enough times. Next time, I'm taking the second one. All right. 7 alien planets. Well, they're not really alien planets then, are they? I mean, they're just 7 planets. But there are 7 planets orbiting TRAPPIST-1, and they are like peas in a pod. Okay, fine. 7 rocky planets orbiting the red dwarf star TRAPPIST-1 have a remarkably similar density, so suggesting they likely have similar compositions as well. Located about 40 light years from Earth, TRAPPIST-1 hosts 7 rocky planets that are about the size of Earth or smaller. The largest group of roughly Earth-sized...
It's okay.
The largest group of roughly Earth-sized planets ever found in a single solar system. Earlier studies measured the mass and diameter of the TRAPPIST-1 planets and found they are rocky or terrestrial, like Earth. However, a new study measured the density of the rocky worlds in greater precision, suggesting that all the planets are about 8% less dense than Earth. Cool.
Yeah. Well... the big thing about this that's not mentioned in the article is that a huge number of those planets would be inhabitable for people like us.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know if there's any life there or not, but there, you know, if you gave us technology so we could easily get there, we could make them habitable.
Cool.
And there are, I'm not gonna dig for the articles, but we can see this, and this just fucking blows my mind. We can see things like the aurora borealis on planets in other solar systems. We can tell what their weather is like in other solar systems. I mean, that's just fucking mind-blowing.
I was going to say, it sounds like we're stalking other solar systems.
Hey, no kink shaming.
I was going to say, there's a major difference between a kink, like an okay kink, and spying.
But yeah, I mean, that, I can see us figuring out, oh, hey, there's a planet here. But to be actually be able to say, oh, there's a planet here and they've got a hurricane right now, or the northern lights on this planet are wildly active, that blows my fucking mind.
I was going to say, I think one of the things with that I think about with that is, I mean, that's good to know to a point. Because it is 40 light years away, which means traveling at the speed of light, it would take us 40 years to get there.
Yeah, yeah.
So, depending on how, you know, with technology and all that fun stuff, how long it took us to get there, knowing there's a hurricane 50, 70, 80 years ago doesn't help.
No, that's true, but it's still...
It is cool.
Yeah. And who knows when we'll actually be able to travel to those places. Or even send a probe there. But it's like, wow, that's... And we learn a lot from things like that, because we can say, okay, this planet has this atmospheric composition and they have XYZ storm. So that tells us things about storms we have on Earth. Which is pretty huge.
See, I was just thinking with this, how, like, how long until somebody decides to try and make some money off it?
About 4 years ago.
Alrighty then.
T. Earl Grey, hot.
Well, on to 3D printing.
Yes. From Gizmodo.com, we're just out here 3D printing meat now, I guess.
Does that mean they have the meat? Because I thought Arby's had the meat.
Somebody's got the meat, although this isn't talking about actual meat.
What?
Yeah. If you can 3D print a gun, if you can 3D print a home, then brother, you might as well pull up a chair and 3D print yourself some meat while you're at it, because these masses aren't going to feed themselves. Thank you. Plant-based meat substitute startup Nova Meat recently unveiled a closer look at the plant-based meat alternative it's been producing with its proprietary 3D printing technology, referred to as the world's biggest whole cuts of cultured meat. The man-made slabs are created from a meat fiber matrix that's blended out of water, vegetable fat, and plant proteins, and designed to mimic the texture, taste, and look of real meat. Okay, I'm just going to say this. The fake meat that I've tried, not as good as real meat. It's not horrible, but it's not you know, it's not quite as good. I mean, if we can get fake meat that tastes like the real thing, I'm all for it. If we can get cultured meat that's identical to real meat, I'm all for it. But I have my doubts about this, that it is as good as real meat. Might still be good, but might not be real meat in taste or whatever.
I was going to say, I had the Impossible Burger, and I thought it was pretty decent. I mean, my only complaint was I didn't think that the kitchen seasoned it well.
I don't remember which one I had, whether it was Beyond Meat or Impossible.
Did I say Beyond Meat or did I say Impossible?
Yes.
Okay, it was Impossible. It was the Impossible Burger. I'm getting tired.
I understand. But one of them I found in a store in patty form, and it's like, I'm going to buy this, see what it's like. And I've heard if you don't follow the directions exactly, it ruins it. So I did follow the directions exactly. And I was like, yeah, parts of this really do taste like actual meat, but there are enough parts of it that don't, that it ruins the taste of the whole thing if you're looking for something that is an actual burger taste. Now, these guys, because they're 3D printing things, may have gotten it on point. I don't know.
One way to find out.
Yeah, well, it's going to be a little while before we can get that stuff, but I'll certainly give it a shot because I would rather eat something other than an actual animal if I could help it. Somebody's clambering around. See, one of the problems I have with a vegetarian/vegan diet is, you know, vegetables are mostly water. Well, I work a physically demanding job, so I got to have really dense sources of nutrition. And if you're saying, well, you shouldn't, you know, use these things, that's fine. But for me to get the high enough caloric intake I need, I gotta just be constantly fucking grazing if I'm not eating meat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, give me something that has the caloric density of meat that costs the same as meat, and I'm your guy. But we're not quite there yet.
Yeah, I'm sure we'll get there. I'm sure the idea is to get there at some point, but
yeah, and I mean, this pushes us a lot closer, and the 3D printing aspect of it could potentially seriously lower the cost. Because that's a huge problem. You know, a bagged salad costs like $3. And it's got maybe 100 calories in it. But if you, you know, order a burger from a fast food joint, it's maybe $1. And it's got twice as many calories or more.
Yeah. Food inequality is.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a bad thing.
That was the most offensive science report I've ever heard. How could you do such a thing?
Beavis helped me.
See, now for sure you're trying to get, because we're talking about cheese heads here. Wisconsin researchers link chimpanzee killing disease. Oh, this sounds great. To a new species of bacterium. Really? Did we not just get, like, We're still in the middle of the pandemic. We do not need another bloody.
Exactly.
Yeah. A new and always fatal disease has been killing chimpanzees at a sanctuary in Sierra Leone for years and has been reported for the first time by an international team of scientists led by researchers at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Badgers. Or is that Wolverines?
I don't know.
I don't know either. All I know is they're cheeseheads. Okay, have you been to Wisconsin? There is a shit ton of cheese in Wisconsin.
Yeah, I've not been, but yeah, I know that's what y'all are famous. They're famous for.
I was gonna say.
I know you're Minnesota, not.
We
Wisconsin.
Have lakes. They have cows. Have you ever had cheese that squeaks? You gotta get the cheese that squeaks.
Yeah.
My brother-in-law did not believe my mother and I when we talked about, and my sister, his wife, when we talked about squeaky cheese. He was like, I don't know what the heck you all are talking about. I've had plenty of cheese and such. And we're like, yeah, but you haven't had squeaky cheese. We go over to Wisconsin. We get some cheese. Actually, I don't think we even went to Wisconsin. I think we went to the Mall of America and they had some packets of, they had some cheese curds you could pick up. And he's like, oh my God, it's squeaking. It's like, yes. Because it's fresh. At least fresher. Back to this great disease. Yay. The disease reported Wednesday in the Nature Communications is caused by a newly discovered species of bacterium and comes as the world wrestles with a devastating pandemic caused by another novel foe, the new coronavirus. Although the chimpanzee's illness has yet to be found in a human being, the two species share about 99% of the hereditary material and or DNA. There are very few pathogens that infect chimpanzees without infecting humans, and very few pathogens that infect humans without infecting chimpanzees. Do we know at least how this one is spread?
No, that's the problem. We got a whole lot of nothing on this stuff.
Which just means it's only a matter of time.
Exactly. That's why I wanted to talk about this thing, because HIV probably made the leap from primates, from bushmeat primates into humans in the 1920s in Africa. So, you know, we didn't realize it was a serious thing until the 80s. So maybe we should change how we deal with this shit, because this has the real potential of doing a species jump. And
no, it's fine.
It's bad. I mean, you know.
Yeah. I was gonna say that was laced with sarcasm.
Oh, I recognize that. Don't worry. I mean, you know, this thing kills the chimps either by the fact that their bodies become filled with carbon dioxide or alcohol, if not both. And
wait, what?
Yeah. Yeah. It's after the bacteria infects a chimp, it starts churning out carbon dioxide and alcohol.
Cool.
Well, if you like blowing up like a balloon and dying when you're drunk, yes.
Again, sarcasm.
Yeah, so this is one of those things. It's like, oh, we need to figure this out and find ways to kill it now. Not when it starts showing up in human populations.
or at least make sure that it's harder to freaking spread.
Yeah.
I mean, if it spreads like Ebola, then at least there's a potential fighting chance for human beings.
Yeah, well, Ebola has a 50% fatality rate, and this has got 100%. So,
Ebola only can be spread though by certain bodily fluids.
Right, and we don't know how this is spread.
Yeah, that's why I'm hoping it goes the Ebola route.
Yeah, but even then, you know, if you test positive for it, you're dead. And that's a bad thing.
I was going to say, we both want similar things. We're just going at it in different directions. Mm-hmm. And there are people who are going to be looking at both of them.
Well,
on that good news.
Let me throw this out there. Stephen King's blurb for the book The Hot Zone, which is about an Ebola outbreak that didn't infect humans, was, "The first chapter scared the hell out of me, and then it got worse from there." If you're scaring Stephen King, you're fucking terrifying. And this shit is worse than Ebola?
Yup.
Yeah.
Great, I was going to say, there's big, major differences between diseases and ghosts.
Yeah, but...
Anyways.
Yeah, it's bad.
Oh, fellow members of the Roman Senate, hear me. Shall we continue to build palace after palace for the rich? Or shall we aspire to a more noble purpose and build decent housing for the poor? How does the Senate vote?
For the poor!
Good.
Yep.
All right.
Okay. Now, this for sure, I'm saying that next time I'm taking the second one, because I don't get to talk about this person.
Oh, yes, you do. A bit. From the WashingtonPost.com. After losing committee assignments, Marjorie Taylor Greene says she has been freed to push the GOP further right. More to the article, but that headline pretty much sums it up. Because if you're going to be pushing the Republicans further right, you're talking genocide.
Oh, yeah.
And
this woman has no boundaries.
Yeah, and I know everybody says, oh, well, sunlight is the best disinfectant. Please, let's remember that Donald Trump got more media coverage than anybody else in the run-up to the 2016 election, and he managed to win.
Yep.
So the real issue here is that she has not been expelled as of yet from Congress, which is what should have happened.
Yeah. Let's see here. Things that she's been noted as doing: harassing a school survivor. She's a huge QAnon fan.
Mm-hmm.
I think one of my absolute favorites is talking on the floor of Congress with a mask that says censored.
Mm-hmm.
Really? Wow. I love how she says that she's going to have a lot of free time on her hands. I'm like, isn't part of your job reading bills? Or are you just going to, go with the headlines? Because I've been looking a little bit more into policies that are being introduced into the Minnesota Senate and House. And, I mean, even skimming takes time.
Yeah.
So, Marjorie Taylor Greene can go away. And, I mean, honestly, I would say her impeachment would not be too far.
No, you're right. Not wrong.
Yeah. There are some who think that she could potentially be the next Trump type, because Trump is probably not going to be the one to be the dictator of America. However, whoever comes after him very, very, very likely could. And I could totally see Marjorie Greene Taylor as one of those. I think one of her biggest contenders would be, what's his name? Howdy?
Yeah, whatever.
Another QAnon.
Uh-huh.
Baca.
Yeah. Now, she's definitely pushing for the VP slot or the presidential slot in 2024.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. She's human garbage. And the thing that has irritated me the most is she gave this quote-unquote apology on the House floor. And she said things like, well, I believe 9/11 happened. And that statement really just means that she believes bad things happen. She does not, it doesn't mean that she accepts what actually happened, because she thinks, you know, she doesn't believe a plane crashed into the Pentagon on 9/11. She's, you know, so you can accept that 9/11 happened, but not accept the, you know, the truth that it was a bunch of terrorist nut jobs that were responsible for it. And that's what she's done. She has said, oh, well, I accept 9/11 happened. She didn't say, I believe Islamic terrorists caused 9/11. The Parkland shooting, she says, well, I believe school shootings happened. But that doesn't mean she accepts Parkland or the other one,
Sandy Hook.
Sandy Hook, thank you. You know, she didn't say, I believe the Parkland shooting was real. And she didn't say, I believe Sandy Hook was real. She just said, I believe school shootings are real. There's a big fucking difference, and lots of people aren't picking up on that.
Well, and one of the issues I have is a lot of times people will bring up things that Democrats have said, or even Joe Biden has said, that are problematic. And then you look at when he said it, and you're like, that was 50 years ago.
Yeah.
I do believe that the man has changed. And not to say that Joe Biden is the perfect person. He's still got a ton to work on.
Yep.
However, it's very clear he does not hold the same views he did 50 years ago. The things that have been about Taylor Greene is months ago, a year ago. And that's a hell of a change to go from walking down the street behind a school shooting shooter survivor talking about how you have a gun.
Right.
Which is literally what happens in her freaking video. She's not even taking the video of this. Somebody else is.
Yeah. Yeah.
So two people are chasing this person who's still fairly young and probably has enough issues with this kind of shit. Yeah. Great job. Great job, Green.
Yeah. And when the Parkland shooting happened, the thing that just got to me was seeing the video of the kids walking out of school. You know, the lead kid's got his hands up in the air and the other kids have their hands on his shoulders. And I'm like, holy shit, that is not an instinctual reaction to those kids. They've been taught to do that so they wouldn't get shot by the cops. That's how fucked up things are. We're training our kids how to present themselves in public so they don't have to worry about getting shot by the cops in a mass shooter situation. That's fucking roll.
Oh, would you like to know something fun? I can't remember if it was Pelosi or Andrea Cortez, Ocasio-Cortez, AOC, who said this. But it was what I believe it was one of the two. Talked about how they very quickly learned how to handle a school shooting situation by listening to their aides.
That was Pelosi. That was Pelosi.
Yeah, because I remember the first time I had to go through that, because that was one of the first times, that's when it started going after Columbine.
Yeah, yeah.
When I was in high school, I was a senior, and we did our first one, and I remember all of us going, if everybody in the school knows how this is done, and the shooter is from the school, how the fuck is this going to work?
I was in my early 30s when Columbine happened.
Oh, I will not forget that day.
Well, I can understand. That was a pretty bad day. And then everybody had to start doing the whole active shooter drills.
Yep.
I did not have anything like an active shooter drill training until I got my current job. That's kind of surprising because active shooter drills are not a thing that should be, but they are. And yet I didn't have to deal with anything on that until I got a job in a unionized workplace. Who do you think cares more about their employees? A company or the union?
Ooh, that's a tough one. You know, those unions are so terrible.
Oh, God.
Yeah. I was going to say, actually, I don't want to say that we didn't have any drills when I started working at my current job at the state, because, to be honest, it was my starting there kind of got, I worked there for a bit, and then so I wasn't in the office for a full year. But the job I had before this, also oddly enough at the state, was at a school, and we did have an active shooter, and it was
kind of scary, to put it mildly.
Well, and we knew it was a drill, so I mean, you know, it was not surprising, so to speak. It was definitely awkward because I wasn't in my office. I was actually in the front area, so I had to go into somebody else's office and with a student and such, and it was just like, I remember the principal being like, well, normally this is when this would happen. However, I'm going to ask you to talk about like what we're doing and why we're doing it. And I'm just looking at this poor kid and I'm like, I am so fucking sorry. You're stuck here with three middle-aged women of varying areas of middle age. Me being, you know, not quite 40. Yeah. This has got to be awkward as hell for you, kid. I mean, something I want any kids to be going through, and it's so frustrating that there doesn't seem to be anything we can do.
Yeah. All right, you want to hit the next one?
With a stick. ABCnews.go.com. Video surfaces showing former President Trump. We're just going to let that sit for a moment. Former President Trump. Ally, man who wears silly hats, Roger Stone, flanked by Oath Keepers on morning of January 6th.
You forgot the fact that he has Richard Nixon's face tattooed on his back.
You know, I'm a geek and a bit of a weirdo kind of thing going on, and I look at Roger Stone and I'm like, man, too far. Too far. That's... I know people who have all sorts of geeky tattoos on them, and I'm looking at this guy going, nah, man, too far.
You are not wrong.
I also don't like the fact that he has made fun hats to be that much more harder to be taken seriously while wearing one.
Yeah, well, you know, it hides the fact that he's a pinhead.
Yes, but some of us like wearing fun hats. The Tripoli was already taken. The bowler was what I had left. Now I'm not sure I have the bowler anymore. And I mean, like, I actually do have a bowler hat, and I'm like, I don't know if I can wear this anymore without being taken like a... Yeah. Like an asinine figure. However, a new video has surfaced showing former President Donald Trump's longtime advisor, Roger Stone, and still current Alex Jones guest.
And still current Trump advisor, even though nobody will admit it.
Oh, God, no. Well, I think he kind of admitted it on one of the more recent Alex Jones shows. Like, I think he's mentioned that he talks with him.
Yeah.
So advisor might be going a bit far. However, longtime advisor Roger Stone the video shows Roger Stone in Washington, D.C. on the morning of July 6th, flanked by members of the Oath Keepers militia group just hours before the deadly insurrection at the U.S. Capitol building. In the video, which was obtained and reviewed by ABC News, Stone takes pictures, mingles with supporters outside a DC hotel as Oath Keepers hover around him, one wearing a baseball hat and a military-style vest branded with the group militia's group logo. So hopefully we have this today, right? Mm-hmm. One supporter asks Stone in the video, which was posted just after 10 a.m. on the morning of the rally. We shall see, Stone replies. Oh, if we could get Stone again.
Yeah, because if you've got Stone, you've got Trump.
However, deposing Stone is not easy. I have actually heard him beat... Now, granted, it was him being deposed by somebody he absolutely has no respect for, though I doubt he has respect for many people. But I have heard a video of him being deposed, and he's not cooperative.
No, he's not. If we're talking about the same video, it quickly becomes apparent dude is not at all connected to reality in the same way that, gosh, I can't figure out a phrase for this because he is just so batshit. He
has his own way of looking at things.
That's putting it mildly.
But it's one of those where it's like the phrase does fit. Mm-hmm. He has his own way of looking at things. He holds his own truth above anything else. He is willing to say anything.
Exactly. Exactly. There's a documentary about him called Get Me Roger Stone. And I cannot bear to watch it because the comments I've heard about it are so horrific. There's just no way I can even contemplate looking at it. Because it has... his politics have no connection or concern about reality. It's just like, well, we want this to be true, so we're going to just pump out crap on that subject until everybody believes it's true.
Yeah. Well, and then it's also the factor, like, so the deposition was, like I said, with somebody who he does not hold in really any esteem at all. And you can just see him messing with him. He's not unintelligent. He is very intelligent, and if he knows how to get under your skin, he will.
Right, right.
My guess is he can read people fairly well, especially dealing with somebody as dramatic as former President Trump. Yeah. He is awful.
That's putting it mildly.
So mildly. Oh my gosh. The factor that he got out of prison time still just makes me ill.
Yep. It does, but...
However... that pardon doesn't mean that he has to testify, so...
Well, also, it doesn't absolve him of things that were done after the pardon.
And this is not a good thing, but also, it does mean... the pardon does mean that he can still work.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was an interesting tidbit I learned. I can't remember where, but it's a part of the from when the Confederacy came back to the Union. All of the people, there was a lot of pardons going on, you know, just to get things back and on track. And this one person, this guy was trying to do jobs, and they're like, "Well, yeah, but you have a felony." And he goes, "Yeah, but I was pardoned." And they're like, "You still have a felony." And it's like, well, okay, so they can't... I think he was trying to get on the bar again to be a lawyer. And basically it was said that he cannot be held from a bar or something like that because of his felony, which was pardoned. Which, fine, whatever.
Yeah, it all depends upon the why he had the felony to begin with.
Yeah. Well, let's hope that this and everything else that's going to be coming out about this.
Yeah. Results in a whole lot of people going to jail.
Yes. And I know that a lot of people want Trump to be, you know, to be go up there and have to touch for like 11 hours, and there is a part of me that does want that. I don't want to give him the time on stage.
Yeah, that's the issue I have. It's like, okay, I see your point, but at the same time, having him up there and rambling about shit, that could inspire worse things, and we don't want that.
I was gonna say, like, my thing would be if, you know, not if, because he's, you know, if he's going to be grilled, he's going to be grilled, but he should be given a 2-minute time for each one. And it's like, you have your 2 minutes to answer the question. Either you answer it, or we consider that basically you're admitting guilt to whatever we're asking. Yeah. End of story.
Yeah.
That's it for this episode of the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. You can subscribe to the show on iTunes, Stitcher, as well as just about anywhere else podcasts can be found. Many of the episodes are also on YouTube. Follow the show on Twitter. At TeaParkAtheist is the show's Twitter handle. It's on Facebook at facebook.com/trailerparkatheist.com. If you happen to like the podcast, please rate it on iTunes. If you'd like to support the podcast, there's a donate button on the show notes page. You can support it via Patreon at patreon.com/TNTucker. Thanks for listening.
Say goodnight, Fuzznuts.
All I know is this violates every canon of respectable broadcasting.
Damned cat.